Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Okay, call and response. Good evening.
Good evening.
Good. Thank you guys for coming out to this water safety meeting. You know, it's a very important issue, and I have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Tommy Chang, who's going to speak a few moments about this meeting. Oh, my name is Monica Lynch, by the way. I work for the Office of Engagement.
Thank you, Monica, and thank you to all those who are here. You know, there are parents here, there are representatives from central office, there are folks from the government. Thank you all for being here. Tonight is an opportunity for us to share information about the recent developments related to lead water testing and the results in our school facilities. Thank you to all that are here. I want to thank Dr. Palfrey for being here to share expertise on the health and well-being of our children. I am also personally dedicated, along with Mayor Walsh, to ensuring that our water sources are meeting and exceeding the standards for our children and educators. As superintendent of Boston Public Schools, I felt firsthand the concerns that many of you have, but please rest assured that we are committed to improving the quality of water in all our schools. Assistant Superintendent of School Operations, Kim Rice, Kim, can you raise your hand? And Chief Engineer at the Boston Water and Sewer Commission, John Sullivan, will further detail more information. John is considered an expert across the country on such issues. Please know that there is nothing more important than the health and well-being of the students and staff at Boston Public Schools. We appreciate all the partnerships. I want to thank Boston Water and Sewer Commission, Boston Public Health Commission, for your partnership and collaboration. And now Monica will provide us more friendly guidelines for tonight's meeting, and Kim and John will provide more information on recent events.
Thank you, Dr. Chang. All right, so as Dr. Chang alluded to, we are going to start off with some information from Kim Rice and John Sullivan, sorry about that, from the Boston Water and Sewer Commission, followed by a presentation from Dr. Palfrey. And then we're going to open it up for question and answers from you. That's the most important part. If you haven't already gotten cards, there are cards available for you to write down your questions that you may have. If you do not feel comfortable coming up to the mic to speak and ask your question, we will be collecting the questions and we can ask them for you. So if you do need a card, please make sure you get a card so that you can get your questions, but you will have an opportunity to voice your questions yourself. So that after those presentations, questions and answers, and then we're going to wrap up. We do have some group norms we'd like to state and ask for agreement on these. Number one is that we're asking that everyone be respectful. We're here to get information, share information, and address the issue. Can we get agreement on that?
Yes.
Thank you. We're asking that everyone listen to and consider the opinions of others. We have experts here who can speak to this issue. And we also want to be able to hear from everyone in the audience. Can we get agreement on that?
Yes.
Thank you. We want to create a space that provides open and honest dialogue. So this is an open and safe space. We need to hear everyone's concerns. And we ask that we honor everyone's voice. Can we get agreement on that?
Yes.
Thank you. We need you to participate by sharing your experiences and opinions, and I know that's why you're all here, so I know we have agreement on that. Allow everyone the opportunity to speak. There will be a time limit for questions, and so we ask that you really honor the time limit so we can make sure we hear everyone's questions and concerns. Can we get agreement on that?
Yes.
Thank you. And last but not least, if you have cell phones, please turn them on silent or turn them off so that we can proceed without interruptions as many as possible. Okay, with that, I think I'm going to turn it over to Kim Rice at this time.
Great, thank you. Good evening. My name is Kim Rice. I am the Assistant Superintendent of Operations at Boston Public Schools. I've been here just under 11 years and am really happy to see the turnout this evening in terms of parents and community members that are looking to learn some more information. Thank you, Superintendent Chang, for kind of kicking us off. It really is under the superintendent and the mayor's leadership that we were really proactive in finding out and identifying the condition of our schools. So what I'm going to be doing is providing a high-level overview. John's going to speak a little bit from his perspective in terms of Boston Water, and then I'll give a little bit more of an introduction to Dr. Palfrey so that the bulk can be set for questions, which we're going to hold until the end. So there's a lot of detail, and so we want to try to simplify this as much as possible. So we do have a website. It's www.bostonpublicschools.org/water. And all of the data, down to every fountain with the multiple tests, is there. So I'm going to try and keep it at a high level to be more of a overview and a descriptor. If you've got particular questions, please either write it down, or again, we'll have some time to be able to go through that. But we want to make sure that we're both explaining the situation and providing all of the data possible so that we make sure that we're getting everyone's questions answered. So we have 126 facilities in Boston Public Schools. And we, as we talk about water, we've been talking about it as being offline or online. Offline basically means that we provide those water, big giant water bubblers that come in, and so that's considered an offline school. An online school is a school that has water fountains that are already set up and in use, and so it's using the Boston, it's using the tap water. So those are the two terms that I'll be referencing. So offline, the water bubblers, the big giant water bottles, and online, which is the tap water with water fountains. So 88 of our schools are considered offline that use the water bubblers. That would leave 38 schools that are considered online. We spend about $400,000 a year on water bottles to provide water bottle access, and for a whole host of reasons. Nonetheless being the health benefits of drinking water, we've been really working towards putting together a plan to move our offline schools online. And so we picked six schools last year that had water that was coming into the school at just about zero parts per billion of lead. And so again, we'll get into more of the technicalities of that. But basically that meant these are really good candidates to put water stations in those schools and bring those schools online. So we wanted this to be the best in the country. We didn't want to just replace the water fountains, so we installed refrigerated hybrid water filling stations. So it's not only the drinking fountain that you put your mouth over, but it's also you can bring up a water bottle and you can actually fill that up. And that's how we want to move forward in Boston Public Schools, with these hybrid water filling stations. So we have been working on a plan to bring these six schools online. Once we got them all installed, and that was completed in about the January-February timeframe, when we did the testing, the lead testing of the water, we got unfortunate results. They did not come back the way that we thought that they would, with them all below the EPA action level. And so we continued to test. We continued to try to figure out exactly what we needed to do to bring them on. Through that process, we started having a conversation about our online schools. I'm sure we've all heard lots of discussions about what the standard is for testing our online schools. So Boston Water and Sewer comes in and they test two schools a year. And it's actually a fountain in a school, so it's two fountains total. So we've been having all these conversations about our offline schools, but we really hadn't thought much about in terms of the discussion on the online schools. And we felt it really important that we test all of our schools so that we know what the lead levels are in all of the schools that we currently have online. So we did just that. So in April, we contracted with a vendor, EnviroTrack, to test all 38 schools. And from that, four schools came back with elevated lead levels. And technically, it's eight fountains out of the four schools total. We immediately shut those down, sent communications out to families, and we're working with Boston Water and Sewer on what is it that we need to do in order to bring those back online. So that's kind of the general gist of of the situation. We've really got kind of two incidents out there. We've got the situation with the six pilot schools. As we were working to improve protocol, to really talk through what we needed to do to create kind of this really exciting opportunity with these hybrid water filling stations, we had a few missteps. There was some documentation, there was a lapse in time in terms of they should never have been turned on, and they were on in a number of our schools. So we're working on that piece. The second being the four, when we tested all 38 schools, we did have four that had elevated lead levels overall. So we are really committed to making all the data available. As I mentioned, we have the website, which has not only a list of all the online schools and the offline schools, but it has all the results for those. We are committed to continue to put every single test that we do online so that families can see what that looks like. I believe we've hugely improved our communications protocol through this pilot, and we'll continue to work with Boston Water and Sewer. And right now we're working with R.W. Sullivan in an effort to bring water and make water clean, potable water available to all of our students in Boston. So I want to stress that we are committed to also doing it right. So while these schools, the schools that tested in our pilot are all offline, so we have right now 92 of those schools then are offline and 34 are online, we want to make sure that we do it right. So we're talking about targeting the end of the summer before school starts to make sure we can get them all back up online, those 10 schools. So with that, I will turn it over to John Sullivan, who's the chief engineer for Boston Water and Sewer.
Good evening, everyone. Again, my name is John Sullivan. I'm the chief engineer of the Boston Water and Sewer Commission. I have worked for the city working with the water department for 44 years. Since 1989, I've been the chief engineer of the Boston Water and Sewer Commission. Let me give you a quick little background on a couple of things. Boston buys its water from the Massachusetts Water Resources Authority. That comes from the Quabbin and Wachusett Reservoir, 65 miles away. Pristine source, one of the best sources of water in the country. According to us, it is the best source of water in the country. So we purchase this water, and it's excellent quality when it gets to our pipes. We then transport it to you, our customers, through a series of cast iron pipes, which do not contribute any lead to the water. If you go to test any of the water in our pipes, there may be small, small amounts, like 0.1 part per billion, but totally insignificant. And most times, it's non-detected in the water we supply. Where the water lead does get in the water is through pipes in private properties. Boston Water and Sewer has replaced all the known lead services that we're responsible for in the city streets. There are none anymore. Now, there may be a couple out there that we don't know about. We've got ancient records. We're going over those records now to prove that we don't have any lead left in the pipes that we own in the streets. Now, those are the pipes that go from the, you know, in the black tar of the street, the sidewalk. That's our territory. That's where we own the pipe. In the front lawns, that's where you own the pipes. So that's very important to know. We stopped using lead pipes in 1934. That's when we stopped putting them in. So any pipes that were in the houses are in homes built prior to 1934. We all talk about lead pipes. What's so very important to know is that brass piping, brass fixtures have lead in them. That's where much of the lead you hear about in schools or in some homes where they've got newer copper is coming from. They used to add lead to the brass to make it more machinable. It makes it easier to work with. So that's why they did it, in order to make the pipe. Since 1986, lead has been banned. In 1991, we were required to start testing and doing corrosion control. Corrosion control is done, we adjust the pH of the water and the alkalinity of the water, a little chemistry, to make the water extremely less corrosive to any metal. That's copper, brass, or lead. We're also required then to test that water and make sure that the corrosivity is working. So you'll hear about the lead and copper rule. You'll hear the 15 parts per billion, that magic number. What that number is, it's an action level that if you're above that, you've got to start taking steps to replace lead in the public way. We've replaced all our lead. Our numbers right now are around 7 parts per billion is our average. We're required to go out and take tests once a year on a series of homes that would probably have lead in them. And they will include copper pipes in your homes that have lead solder. Those were generally put in before 1986. So you can have a house built in 1980, you think you get everything brand new, and you could be having problems with lead leaching in. Now, I say problems. Lead can get in there. If you flush that water, if you let that run in the morning, 1 or 2 minutes, or if you shower first, or if you flush the toilet first, and then have water in the refrigerator waiting, you're going to get water from our mains that is free of any potential lead that could have leached into that pipe. Copper also leaches in the pipe, so it's good measure anytime is to flush the water. Drink the water that's cold. You can tell it's fresh water because out in the street it's about 55 degrees. Inside your home, it's probably around 70 degrees. That's a good way to tell if you get the nice cold water. So we've been going through this issue of working on lead for many, many years. In 1934 we stopped it. We've been replacing lead services and we've got them all out. We also have programs to help homeowners. If you've got a lead pipe, you can go on our website, you put your address in. If you have any questions, you call us, we will go to your home and we will investigate and see if you've got a lead pipe coming in your home. That's how concerned we are with it. Mayor Walsh has made it the utmost important thing we do is to work with schools, but work with our customers, work with people who are unsure of this. If they call, we're to go up there and take care of this particular concern that they may have. Now, just as a background, I was sent to Flint, Michigan. I'm still advisor for them on their lead problems. I work nationally with across the nation with water utilities working on the lead problem. I can tell you that Boston Public Schools is far ahead of any other school system across this nation in the concern they have on working on this particular problem. Their problem seems to stem more from old brass piping. And so we're looking at a whole host of things to make it sure that we can get the amount of any lead that gets in there will not get to a bubbler, will not get to any children. So that's something is our goal, and the mayor has made it in no uncertain terms to us to work with the schools to achieve that. So that's where we are, and I'll answer any questions if they come up later.
Great, thank you. So next, Dr. Sean Palfrey is going to give us an update. I just wanted to give you a little bit of his background. Dr. Sean Palfrey has been a pediatrician, teacher, and advocate for better child health policies in Massachusetts since 1974. He's worked and taught at Harvard, Tufts, UMass, and Boston University Medical Schools, and is currently a professor of pediatrics and public health at Boston University and Boston Medical Center. He has served as the president of the Massachusetts chapter of American Academics of Pediatrics, and has spent much of his life working to improve access to health care for all children and to prevent lead poisoning, vaccine-preventable diseases, and injuries and death from gun violence and other serious problems. Dr. Palfrey has run lead poisoning prevention programs in Massachusetts in conjunction with the State Department of Public Health, the Boston Public Health Commission, for decades. During this time, lead poisonings have become much less severe, but exposure to lead in our communities from lead-containing paint, dust, water, and other sources is still an issue of significant public health and educational concern and requires our continued attention. So thank you so much for being here this evening, and I'll turn it over to you.
Can you hear me on my microphone, or should I use the... Okay, fine. So thank you for inviting me here. I'm Sean Palfrey, and I've been in Massachusetts as a pediatrician working with many of your children for almost 40 years. I've run lead poisoning prevention programs in central Massachusetts in the 70s and 80s, and then since 1989 have run the Boston Lead Poisoning Prevention Program here with the Boston Public Health Commission at Boston Medical Center. So I've seen almost all of the children in Boston who have had elevated lead levels over that period of time. And I work with a very eager and talented group of people from the Public Health Commission who literally go out, as many of you may know, to the houses, to your houses, to see what the sources of the increased lead levels that children might have around Boston. In terms of that history, when I was in medical school in the 1970s, we didn't know about lead poisoning, really. It was at that point that we were started to discover that it was so pervasive because we started to screen children. And pediatricians screen your children for lead poisoning at 9 months, usually 9 to 12 months, and then 18 to 24 months. So almost every child in this state gets screened at those ages. Massachusetts is wonderful for a number of different public health reasons, and I'm very proud to be a part of this team because we screen kids much more closely and much more consistently than any other state. So we do have a good sense of how children are exposed to lead in their environments. What we know is that lead poisoning is related to the younger the child, the longer they've been exposed, and the higher the lead level. And so almost all children who have levels of lead of any significance are under 2 years of age. And the reason for that is simply because they crawl around their houses. And the primary source these days for lead in their environment is in the old paint that happens to be out there, or the dust that gets stirred up when people are renovating their houses. It is not from water. It is no longer from gasoline. It's no longer from soil, although these are sources. So when a child gets referred to us by their pediatrician, us being the clinic that I run at Boston Medical Center, we will go out and we will look across all the sources of lead in their environment. We will work with you to decrease any exposure. We will work with the city and the state departments of public health to get rid of those sources, and we will work with the children. One of the things about this current issue of lead in the water at schools is that older children than age 4, 5, 6, and we as adults, are very rarely significantly poisoned at all. And the reason that's true, one is that older children are not at the level of eating paint. Paint, by the way, is sweet and chewy, and kids will go back and eat it. So that's why we focus so much on lead in paint. Lead in water is very rare, and as the commissioner said, if you run your tap for 30 seconds to a minute to bring the water temperature down to cool, you are going to have essentially none, even in a house that has some lead in the pipes coming into the house. So the source of lead poisoning from water in this state is minuscule. And the risk of a child who is school age, older, right, from any kind of source, but particularly from water in a fountain, which they drink for no matter of seconds, anywhere throughout the day, after many people have been drinking that water, is almost vanishingly small. So I, as a pediatrician, and I, as a lead poisoning expert, am not worried, and I want to reassure the parents who are in this room, that their children have been poisoned in any significant way at all from the water in the fountains in the Boston Public School System. That's not where our problem is. We will work for it, and as you've heard, we are very meticulous, we being the city and the state, to try and get rid of any fountain that might have some lead in the solder or lead in the pipes. And we are working at every level to try and get the lead out. But to be very honest and reassuring, this is not the source that we need to worry about. If we have worry at all, it still happens in your communities, in your houses. And so I am here largely to answer the questions that worried parents and worried teachers might have about the sources of lead in your school or your community or your child. And if any of your children had elevated lead levels as 1, 2, or 3-year-olds, I probably have seen them. And if I haven't seen them, than my colleagues in the Boston Public Health Commission have seen them and been out to the houses and investigated the sources in the houses or in their environment, including the schools. So I think perhaps I should stop there and open this to any people's individuals' questions, what risks they might be running, and to help you define these risks and reassure you about our children's health.
Thank you, Dr. Paltry. Okay, so we are going to start our question and answer portion. I just want to reiterate, if you have a card with a question or if you need to write down a question on a card, if you don't want to speak into a mic, please make sure you get a card. We have Mark Racine, who will be walking around with a microphone for those who want to ask your question. Lauren Mallord will be capturing your questions and comments and concerns on the chart paper. Latoya can give you, raise your hand, Latoya. Latoya and Charlene should be in there also, but Latoya is here to give you a card if you want to write, if you want to write your question down, and we will collect it. Just a reminder for this portion, we do ask that you honor the time limit. We are going to limit the questions to 2 minutes. So what I will be doing is I will show you a 1 minute sign when your 1 minute is up. Like so, I'll let you know you have 1 minute, and then when you have 30 seconds left, I'll show you 30 seconds, and when your time is up, we will ask that you kindly wrap up. I'll give you this indication, okay? So, at this juncture, we will entertain questions. I see a question, I saw a hand go over there.
Hi, my question is, how much water would a person, a child or an adult, actually have to drink at the levels that have been present in our schools to be poisoned or have any adverse effects?
My response to that is an enormous amount.
Okay.
So much that they would never possibly drink it back. What happens with the body, with these tiny little amounts that they might be exposed to in the air or wherever else it is, the body's pretty good at getting rid of that fairly quickly. What we worry about is if they ate a paint chip, which is basically made of lead. But drinking water with the amount of lead that's in that water, it would be an enormous amount of water that no child would drink. And by the way, there's only going to be lead in that water for maybe the first 30 seconds anyway, because it will otherwise be flushed out.
Hi, good evening, how are you? So I have a few questions and I will limit it to 2 minutes. The first question is, how do we decide what two schools are going to be tested each year, and why are we not testing all the fountains in the school? Because I know that some fountains do not ever go like cold. So kids complaining that the water is warm. And what does that mean? Does that mean that there's lead in the water? That's my first question. And my second question is, for the schools that are offline, I know that some kids will go to the restrooms and fill their bottles up in the restroom. So does that mean that there is also, is there the chance that lead will be in that water as well? And I think that is my last question.
So on the two schools, it's a requirement of the lead and copper rule. The requirement is that we test two schools. So we contact, the Boston School contacts the school department, and we talk about which ones are the oldest and with the more prevalent potential of lead. So we pick two schools a year and we go to two locations in those schools. That's a requirement of the regulation. So that's how they're picked. We contact, and they're different. So it'll be two different years. The second question, did that answer the first question?
It did, but I also have a question about how can we change that?
Okay, well.
So one of the recommendations that we made for our updated water policy was to test all schools every year. And so in addition to what Boston Water and Sewer does and will continue to do, Our recommendation was every school every year. The other thing that we are doing, which is an upgrade, is we used to have one sign that would say for hand washing only in a bathroom. Now we're putting signs up that every sink gets a sign. So there'll be a sign over every sink, even locked custodial slop sinks that you wouldn't think. And anywhere there's a sink, we'll be putting up a sign that says for hand washing only. I should note though, as part of this, a lot of our offline schools, most of our offline schools have good water. They just don't have a physical fountain yet. And we need to go through this process in order to bring them on. But that is one thing we are doing as part of that.
So you have tested those offline schools, and I haven't done that for this one, I promise. You have tested those offline schools and their water faucets to make sure that there is not lead in those water faucets. Because my son is at an older school, and they don't even have water fountains in the school. But that is a question, concern of mine.
Right, so many of the older schools that are considered offline, the faucets were physically removed from the walls. So you're right, a lot of them don't even have the faucets. So we had done testing. The focus was not, though, on those faucets, which is why we're doing the signs. But we are going to make sure that going forward, any schools we're bringing online and all of the online schools will be tested.
Thank you.
Sure.
Just a follow-up comment on the signage. You know, my child's at an early learning center, at the West Zone Early Learning Center, where the three-year-old isn't going to be able to read the sign. And I do think symbols are going to be important also for language barriers, et cetera, that might be experienced elsewhere. And signs that are durable and bolted to the wall so that they don't. Anyway, but that's not my question. I want to dive into the 15 parts per billion. I'm very concerned about that. I remember reading that at the Hernandez, one of the fountains was under the level at 11 parts per billion. And thinking to myself, who's going to drink out of that fountain? I mean, it's under the acceptable or under the level of 15, but it still obviously has high lead content. And I went and checked the Flint water research website, I'm not sure which one, but they're measuring at 5 parts per billion and above as a health concern. And I'm just curious if there's a difference between a regulatory concern where, okay, we're fine, we're the government, we're forcing action to be taken, and is there a difference between a regulatory concern where action has to be taken versus what is appropriate for health, especially again, at my school where there's K-0 kids, you know, 3-year-olds running around, tiny little bodies, I just want to unpack that standard and I want to understand that and the safety behind it.
Right, so the standard of 15 came up from the EPA after they did a bunch of studies. It used to be 50 parts per billion. That's what we used to think back in the 1980s was the right number, 50 parts per billion. Above that was a number of concern. They lowered it to 15, and the 15 was you had to try to treat your water for corrosion control, and if it was over 15, you had to take positive actions going out looking for lead pipes and removing them. And that was the call. They didn't say you had to go and find any brass pipes to remove. You had to remove lead pipes. So it was a number that was given to us by EPA. EPA is now looking at that number. Ever since this Flint problem occurred, they're looking at what should the number be. There are the legislative bodies have been out there saying maybe they should be 10, maybe they should be 5. So there is no set number on that. That's just a spot at which a water utility needs to take some action. So that's where that number came from. Flint has chosen the arbitrary number of 5. That's just the number they picked. People pick different numbers. So right now, we're just using the 15 action level, getting all the numbers below that. Again, if you flush these lines, you can get those numbers way down. When you see a number posted because they took a test a particular way, you have to let the water sit for a minimum of 6 to 8 hours. Then you take a test. Then you can flush it for 30 seconds, and you take another test. So that's just so you can have a standard protocol. If you flush that thing for 2 to 3 minutes, you can get those numbers way down.
3-year-olds don't, you know.
Yeah, I'd like to answer that for you, or at least start to address it. I was asked to go speak at the House of Representatives in Washington to the Education Commission, the committee, about Flint and about what they were suggesting we should be doing. What we found out from the Flint levels is there's a very different issue about what you're exposed to in the water and what the children's lead levels end up being. So when they studied all the kids in Flint, the lead levels did increase somewhat, but none of them to a worrisome or a significantly worrisome level, which surprised me. So that the figure was statistically that the number, percentage of children with a lead level over 5, which is what they were looking for, doubled, went from 2 point something to 4 point something. So that's a statistics, okay? But we worry about blood levels, and the blood levels themselves in these children did not increase, which was quite reassuring given the extraordinary contamination in Flint. This is not Boston water fountains. What you're talking about there is all sorts of bacteria and other chemicals and fluctuations of lead in the water that were massive, up into the thousands instead of 15. So I want to reassure you, because these are my kids, just as they are your kids that we care about, translating some parts per billion in a water fountain to actually poisoning a child is a very difficult thing to do. And in fact, it takes much more exposure to lead to get a child's lead level up to a point that we're worried about than the amount of water in these fountains. Does that help a little bit?
For now.
Okay.
Charles Clemens Mohammed. My understanding is that once a person is ingest the lead, that it stays in the bloodstream for 24, 48 hours, and then after that, it attaches itself to the organs. My question is, knowing that, what type of tests will be followed with those children that drunk this, had this water? But then the other thing is we have to look at our elderly also who drink the water, and because they're older, they are not able to fight off things like they used to. So if you could address that, please.
Sure. As I said to you that in the beginning, that the body is pretty good at getting rid of low levels quickly. So if you drink a little bit, it doesn't stay around in your body for 24 hours. It gets peed out pretty quickly. If you eat a lot, it gets into your digestive system. You have paint and chip in there that's continuously giving out the lead, and that can get into your blood. It will get into your blood. Most of it will get peed out in your urine, but some of it does get stored, and this is where we worry about it. The stores are in fat-active places in the body, and for little children in the first 3-4 years of life, those fat-active places are the brain. So a small amount does get up into there if you're exposed to a great deal, well beyond the kind of levels that we're talking about from drinking in a fountain or a faucet. But you're right that some of that does get stored. And then very slowly, over time, the body gets rid of that too. If it gets really high, we can help it with medications. But that's the very unusual circumstance, and I don't think I've ever seen a child from this country or any other country who is contaminated from water who requires chelation, say.
And real quick, yeah. Are there kits available for the public to obtain so that we can test our water?
I know that we can test your water for you through the Public Health Commission system. So if your child were found to have an elevated lead level and we can't discover what that source is, we can then go out to it, take some water, and test it for you. I don't know about that.
There's no catch. If we were to go test it, we would grab a sample, 250 milliliters or so, and bring it in. When we test ours, we're required to have a certain size bottle, certain amount of time. We have to rely on the homeowners to do the testing for us. Right now, we don't test. We don't offer free tests. It's about $30 for a private lab to grab a test and sample. The key is how you take it. If you get up in the morning at 11 o'clock in the morning, you decide, I think I'll test for lead, you probably have flushed any potential lead you might have had in that house away, and you'll get that reading at that time for that sample of water. So it's very important if you test for lead to take it after it's been sitting in the house with no other water being used, and then you draw that sample.
I'm almost a little bit perturbed. And the reason why that is because if there's so little lead in the water and that the staff comes in before the children, then why is it that the water problems are shut down? As a parent and a long person that lived in this community for a long time, and it was said that, especially for homeowners in this area, that you cannot rent to people who have children under 6 years old because of lead that can affect these children. So when I hear the numbers, you know, 3, 4 in the Boston Public Schools, and these fountains have been shut down, and I know that we don't know a lot about lead, because we don't have a whole lot in our water that we know about. We're still practicing this thing. And so here we have children in the inner city, in Dorchester, right? One of our schools, the Murphy School, where my children go, Holmes Elementary, Tech Boston, in Dorchester. It just seemed like it's so ironic. And these fountains have been shut down. So it's almost like, it's not going to harm you, but we're going to shut them down.
Thank you. So it really is more out of an abundance of caution. We did get some feedback from folks, especially the Murphy. The Murphy had only one of its fountains that tested at 16 parts per million, and so that's just one part per million over the action limit. And so some people did say, it's not that bad. All the other fountains are safe for drinking. We found that that's a tough message. Right, we want to make sure that what we are doing as we are moving forward, that everybody's really clear. We want you to be excited about this. We want you to drink water. There's huge health benefits to drinking water. And so because this is so complicated, and even as we talk about parts per billion and lead and copper and solder and all that kind of stuff, I sometimes get confused as to what we're actually talking about. So we want to make sure that it's a really clear message and that you can be sure that the water that you're drinking is safe. So we are working to bring these schools back online as quickly as possible in a very calculated, very documented way so that we're able to tell the story. It's unfortunate that we have the miscommunications in our 6 pilot schools. I think if we didn't have that, we'd be in a different place right now. But we, that wasn't well documented. And we're kind of backing out of that so that when all those schools become online and as we then start talking about additional hybrid water filling stations, that everybody is really clear, they know where to get the results. And also our communications protocol is the same. So that, if something happens, then this would happen. And then we communicate to families. So that's really where we are, especially with the Murphy.
Okay, and just one other thing. And I want to be clear, and I hear what you're saying, but in this community, in Dorchester, Roxbury, and Mattapan, where we already receive a whole lot of little debt, it is very tough for the parent in this community where our budgets are going, our budgets are being driven by a district that don't have enough for the children that it services. And so here it is, another whammy for our community. And we want to trust. We do. But we know that we hear that so often and we know that we're still practicing. And for some reason, this community is being used as guinea pigs to figure things out. And that is a hard blow for me.
Thank you. I just want to remind people, Latoya and Charlene are in the audience collecting any cards or giving out any cards that you might have. This is a question from the audience. Can we provide more explicit signs for students around the drinking of the water, such as can the sign say simply, do not drink the water?
I'm assuming this is for faucets?
Yes. We could.
I mean, I think what we were trying to do is similar to the comment about kind of the universal symbol. There is a symbol that's going to be associated with the signs that have younger students, and in some instances, the water. It's not that it's bad water, and that it's not drinkable. It's just that we want you to use the water for hand washing only. So we could definitely take that into consideration. We were trying to create a universal sign that would allow for kind of that level of communication.
Yes, that's me. Good evening. Jeff Durham, D-U-R-H-E-N. I'm a father of three children off of the Boston Public Schools. One that's almost graduating from college, and the other two are preparing through BPS, and my younger one actually is a student at Murphy's. I commend you guys. Thank you. Being here, doctor, thank you. Superintendent, thank you. Price, thank you. This is where I'm somewhat disappointed. Three brief bullet points. Boston Public Schools has 85,000 children. And as a parent, I was notified of this meeting on Friday. It's now Monday. We look at this room. Three quarter of it is pressed. You said it, keep doing everything possible. Okay? This room in this turnout position. Where do we go from here? Our kids were treated like guinea pigs. Fountains are shut off in my child's school. We took action steps. Mayor Walsh stepped up. Superintendent stepped up. Thank you. But why weren't the public made aware of this testing? And how come the hybrid fountains didn't occur at libraries prior to our school? Standardized work goes a long way. Finally, Mayor Walsh, bring back those two employees. Thank you.
So let me just address the first point in terms of the meetings. We talked about that, and we are going to have, we're going to hold more sessions. We're going to be out and meeting with families at schools as well. It was a balance between wanting to get the information out as quickly as possible and hear from folks so that we could make this available. So you'll note we're recording the session. The session's going to be posted online. We've got another session tomorrow. We're working with individual schools to schedule time where we can meet with families. So this is just the first of a number. Actually, it's the second. We've already met. We've gone out to a number of the schools already and met with folks. So this is just the beginning. We realize it was quick, and we're thrilled with the turnout that we do have. We're actually thrilled with the media that they can help us communicate. So we are going to continue to do that. So I appreciate you mentioning that. As far as the hybrid water filling stations, that's not an experiment. Those are tested and true. They're great systems. They're in gyms and airports and all over the country. So that's not the pilot. The work that we are doing with Boston Water and Sewer is around what is the work effort needed to install them in these buildings that the pipes have been dormant for 15, 20 years. And so working on that process to do that. And so again, the six schools, which the Murphy was not one of, but the six schools that were already offline, these schools were off, had pretty much zero parts per million as part of the overall number, and we were working to bring them online. And so we want to make sure that we're really clear with that process, both for these current six and any new school going forward.
My name is Anna Ross. I have two children who attend Mather Elementary School. My daughter is in the third grade. My son is in kindergarten. And the fountains at the Mather were on for 2 weeks. I believe that's the longest period that any of the fountains were left on in any of the schools. So they were on from the 23rd of November to the 14th of December. And we were given a letter from our principal in February telling us that there had been some issue with those fountains, that they'd been turned on and then turned off. That was pretty much the extent of the information we received there then. And then I got a letter home on May 4th, dated May 4th, and it had much more extensive information about which fountains were tested and what time and when and what the actual numbers were. I'm looking here at the fountain NR205 right outside the door of my son's kindergarten class. On November 24th, the initial test was 0.203, and then the flush was 15 parts per billion, but it was left on. It was then tested again on the 14th, and even after it was initially tested at 0.73, and then it was tested again after the flush at 0.78, so I don't know why it would have gone up after the flush. And I gather that was when it was decided to turn all those fountains off. So I'm just quite concerned that it took until May 4th for me to get this information. It really seems to run contrary to this culture of we that Boston Public Schools is hoping to cultivate here. And I'd just like to understand the thought process behind, first of all, not even giving us initial, very thin information until February, and then waiting until May 4th to provide this full information. And further, how as a parent with two kids in BPS, and I'm hoping they'll stay there, I want them to graduate from high school with BPS, but what can you do to reassure me that they're not going to need to bring water from home for the rest of their tenure in BPS? I mean, how can I trust you again? What kind of measures are you gonna put into place? How are you gonna help me believe that you are really giving me the information I need? Because right now, I feel as though you have withheld crucial health information from me as a parent. And that's not only unethical, it's poor practice at building community. Thank you.
So part of what we're working towards, and I appreciate your comments, and I'm sorry. This pilot has been really tough, and what we wanted to be able to do was to get everyone all the information, but some of it was it was unclear. And so as we had information that we could share and as we learned exactly what was going on, we were making the information public. And so it definitely wasn't fast enough. And part of what we are doing now, as all the protocols, and we've got the website set up, we've got the way to collect data, we're using external providers to do the testing rather than internal folks. I believe we're in a much better place, but we have to earn your trust. We have to earn the trust of our families again. We are committed to every test we take, the data being online, all of our fountains being below the EPA action level, and the second that any testing is done and we learn that it's over, we're going to shut them down and make that and communicate to parents immediately as to what has happened. Part of what we didn't quite have those cogs in the wheel yet, and in terms of talking about the pilot, and we were getting different information about what we had and when we had it. So we're working on ironing all of that out. But I'm committed. The district is committed to using our website as that place in which we'll make all of that data available, so that you don't necessarily have to just trust us, you'd be able to see that information as well. And we'll work with you and your principal and the facilities department and the health and wellness department, Boston Water and Sewer, and reaching out to partners to make sure that we're accountable for that information and in working with you.
So by immediate, I mean, like, do we get to know that day? That's really what we need. We need to know that day. Right? So how immediate is immediate?
That's a good question. Part of what we will have is what the expectation of timing will be part of that protocol. And I don't mean to sound vague. Again, this is part of where we are moving forward and being really, really clear and really transparent about what it is that we would do. So ideally, it would be that day. One of the things that we heard was that people were upset that they got a robocall. They would have rather have us go to the school and have a meeting at the school before anything was sent out. Others love getting the call and getting the information. So again, we're going to be presenting to the school committee again. The school committee has asked us to tighten up our water policy to make it a little bit, I don't want to say tougher, that's not what I mean, but they've asked for some additional pieces to be in it. One of those things will be a timeline and an expectation for communication. So we will have that there. So, but I would say that the expectation, or our expectation, is to make sure families have all the information as quickly as we possibly can get it out. And what we did with this pilot was not quick enough. We are definitely committed to working through this. And again, that's why we're taking the time now to make sure that we've got the website set up, we've got the protocol in place, we've got the letter set and translated. I mean, again, part of this is all what we're working towards, so that we can snap our fingers and make sure that information is available.
Hello, good evening. Hello. Good evening, my name is Liz Harris, and I have children in Westwood in the Boston Public School Systems. This evening, I understand y'all having the talk around Boston Water and Sewer and the faucets and water and lead. My question for the school of Boston Water and Sewer mainly is, what are we also doing about the pipelines and the grounds that also lead to our school buildings across the city, as well as other developers? With a lot of ongoing construction and development going on in the city of Boston, I think it's important that this isn't just one conversation pertaining to faucets and pipes in the school, but also what is Boston Water and Sewer and the MWRA going to do to ensure the quality of water on the ground, because we are dealing with piping as well, that hold not just for developers who are tearing down and rebuilding buildings with the area, but they're also connected on, somewhere on the main street or, next to the school district. We've got a lot of schools in different districts, and there's a lot of buildings. So my concern right now is with that ongoing construction and things like that, not just the piping in our schools, but what plans does the Boston Water and Sewer and the MWRA have together so that we can ensure that lead in itself and those pipes as well are being serviced or, remodeled or, like to avoid running into lead or asbestos and et cetera.
Right, as I mentioned earlier, the Boston Water and Sewer has replaced all of its lead pipes in the city streets. As far as the public schools go, we have been working with them since the early 90s to identify any place that need any type of lead pipe. In general, all the schools had very large pipe. They were cast iron pipes. There was no lead in them at all. They were put together with lead joints, but that lead is protected with some stuff called oakum that protects it from bleaching. And so the majority of pipes going into city schools are 3 and 4 inch, which never were made of lead to begin with. A couple of schools did have some lead, and that was replaced by the school department back in the 90s. So we do test the water right up to where it comes to the meter, and we're finding non-detects. We are not delivering any water to schools that have any amount of lead. So that's very good news. And now what we're doing is we're working with the school department to find out how can we make sure inside those schools that the brass piping, again, it's not lead pipe, it's brass pipe. But brass piping in schools, remember, schools don't use water the way homes do. When you get up in the morning, there's no one inside a school flushing, there's no one inside a school shower. So the water sits there a little longer. So it's a different animal than our homes are. So we're working with them, we're investigating every one of these schools before they get turned on. We're going to be going with the facilities department to make sure we understand how the water will get from our very good source all the way to the drinking fountains and make sure that it's open.
And one quick question. You said some of them were built with cast iron pipes. Two questions. How long ago were they installed? And with iron, does that mean it rust at all or no? I'm not familiar, about that. And how long ago were they installed into the schools? You said all the school districts.
That's correct. And so the ages vary, but if a building was built in 1910, if the cast iron pipe were there, it's probably still there.
Latin School on Louis Pasteur Ave, or Latin Academy on Warren Street.
Latin Academy, we're happy to look at that now. Two of the pipes are brand new. We put them in 2 years ago. And the other one is, one of the pipes is older. It's probably tuberculated. It looks like bumps. It's rust is inside the pipe.
But does that cause health problems or not?
No. The tuberculation gets there, it sits there. You would see it if there was any kind of rust coming out, it'd be brown water. So, every now and then you may see discolored water.
Yeah.
That is generally the iron that's in some of our pipes when there's a disturbance in the system, and it flushes out.
I was gonna say you let the water run until it turns.
That's correct.
Oh, okay.
Hi, I'm Ann George. I'm a parent at the Curly Cave. And I have three quick questions I'd like to just throw out there, and you can get to those because they're not nearly as important as the last one. So first I wanted to know if filters could play a part in removing lead. And also, when did that testing occur that did happen? Was it first thing in the morning? Was it the end of the day? I just was curious about that. And then whose budget is this coming out of? Because we cannot afford to take it out of the BPS budget. So I'm just wondering if this has been identified yet. And my last issue is the solution has been to provide bubblers at the schools. And our bubblers in our school, which has 925 students in it, and was a merging of two schools became one. And when I'm thirsty at that school, I cannot locate a bubbler. If I do, it has no water in it. Behind a closed door or locked door is where it might be also. So these are just access to water. What we found is in our cafeteria during lunch, our cafeteria staff was buying water and selling it to our students at a premium. They were definitely making some money off of the students for something we were legally obligated to provide. So we're struggling with sorting this out and understanding how this hasn't been a priority for 30 years. Had you done one a year or two a year, BPS that is, or the city, for the past almost 30 years, we would be much further along than we are now. It's disturbing. And I know, Kim, you and I have had this conversation around water. I know you want water for our kids. Why can't we get enough bubblers if that's the temporary solution? We need enough that we can actually access. And the other part of that is no one is contractually obligated to fill the water. So nobody's willing. So we have our 10-year-olds, 11-year-olds, they're hauling the water from time to time. There's no access to water already. This is a problem even if you fixed it. We do not have, not fixed it, but provided all the bubblers. There's no one to fill them. So can we look at, can the people who deliver the water at Poland Springs bring it to each bubbler, or I don't know, I've been concerned about the water issue for a long time, and everybody here has. us. But if we could work on that in the meantime, and many of us would appreciate it. Thank you.
I'm going to quickly hit the filters that remove lead. The answer to that is yes. There are filters that can remove up to 99% of any lead in the water as long as it's not exceedingly high number. The problem in schools is once you're serving more than 25 persons in one building, you become a separate public water system if you treat the water. And the other problem there is that the Boston Public Schools don't have certified operators to operate the system. Boston Water Sewer does have certified operators. We serve the city. So we're trying to work with the schools, with DEP, with EPA, to find out how we can go ahead and can we go ahead and set up a system where we can monitor, and have a certified operator monitoring it. So that is one of the solutions that we're looking, as we said earlier, we're working together. That's one of the potentials. It's not necessarily the bubbler that you put in is not the problem. It's generally the pipe leading to the bubbler. And you can imagine how many miles of pipes are in these schools. So that's another thing that we're looking at. What is the most efficient way of getting this done? Because it does come out of the Boston Public Schools budget. So that brings that together, and now Kim wants.
Okay, so the question about when did we do the testing? The testing was done first thing in the morning before anybody entered the building. So it had overnight to sit in the pipes. And then we did a 30-second flush. So there were two tests on every fountain that we tested, and both sets of results were made available. It does come out of the BPS facilities budget. This year was a capital expenditure, and part of what we've been working with the water the committee on is what is an overall return on investment strategy for the about $400,000 we spend on bottled water a year, and at what point in conjunction with the facility master plan, if we can be retrofitting. So anytime we have to replace a boiler or do other type of internal plumbing, we would add the fountains to that to be able to potentially bring that back online. So we are proposing to be working in kind of a five-year cycle once the facility master plan comes out, and this would be in alignment with that type of work. In terms of your particular question with the curlies and water bubblers, let's talk, because we've been adding water bubblers as needed to make sure, and the vendor's been really good about providing them, so we can definitely see to make sure. Your question about your comment about bottles locked in closets or locked in offices and having no one that's responsibility to lift the water onto the water bubblers is accurate. Again, one of the reasons why we want to get these water filling stations set up and going, because it's kind of a community approach to see who can help lift the bottle and put it up on the station. So we're working on that. We're working with facilities to see if we can identify folks, and with principals and assistant principals to see who might be kind enough within the particular school. And every school is different. So we're trying to work through each of those particular access items. And I think I got through the list.
Hi, my name is Andrea Williams. I'm on Public Health Security at Kirk Gate. Thanks for the guys. Just to go back to a little bit of the construction part of the problem, knowing that the water was turned off in 1988, it seems a little odd, as Anne, my co-work, Anne was saying, that there was no actual municipal plan to improve the infrastructure in 30 years, roughly. Is there any historical information or anything that you could provide to us as to why that actually happened? Like why would we be changing out all the pipes in the streets of Boston, but ignoring our municipal buildings that were directly related to K-12? Because I know that the municipal buildings, government municipal buildings, were changed out. We have a Green Communities Act, we've done all these things related to certain pockets of public buildings, but we ignore the school buildings in Boston.
Thank you for the question. And before you answer, I just want to say we're probably going to be able to take one or two more questions after this one. So if we don't get to your questions, please make sure you write it on the sticky and provide it. We will have a process to be able to get answers out to you. So one or two more after this, and then we're going to start to close out.
Thank you.
question, and I don't have the answer. I don't know if you do, but there is a lot of information that we've been going through. So I think what I would say is I'll take that as an action item and make sure that's part of the information that we share out. Because I'm assuming that there's got to be some information that responds to historically what has gone on or why that has or has not been addressed. I actually don't know if there's some work in some areas where that has been addressed. So I'll look into that, and we'll make sure that's part of our answers that we post online. Yeah, we can follow up. Yeah.
Hi, I have a question. You said that lead pipes stopped being used in the 1930s, but in BPS, you have a lot of schools that are built, like you said, like in 1910. So like within the schools, is it possible that there's lead pipes in some of our schools? And are there any other sources of lead in our schools besides the water and the pipes in our schools, like any other sources of lead? And in light of parents being afraid of the water, rightfully so, is it possible that all of our schools have access to the Poland Springs funnels?
I'll go with the last question first. How about that? So we have 34 schools that are tested below the action limit, and their water is safe for them to be drinking. And so those are online. In those schools, in a number of them, there are also water bubblers. So whether they be in the nurse's office or cafeterias, and we've got lots of different access points in those schools. And so because they've got good water, there really isn't a reason to add more of those bubblers there. In all the other schools, so in the 92 other schools where it's offline, those have been using water bubblers and will continue to use them. And as I mentioned about the Curly, if folks have access issues and need some more, we can definitely get to a point where we can do that more for the school.
Yeah, relative to the installation of lead lines, that was what the city was doing to bring the water from the major pipe in the street into a building. So they ceased doing that, bringing the pipe up to the meter in 1934, 1935 era. Inside the buildings was a whole different story. Sources of lead, generally known as lead pipes themselves, which are the worst because they're solid lead all the way through. Brass piping, which is extremely common in the 1926 era homes. So in the homes that were built, they might have had a lead pipe coming in, and the pipes inside the homes were brass, and most of the schools had brass. That was a very common piping material. Every fixture that was ever installed in the sinks, in the fountains, and everything else is made of brass. Even today, plastic, it takes over a little bit, but if you get a very fancy fixture, it's made of brass. The new brasses are prohibited from having a lot of lead. They look minuscule amounts of making machinery. So they call them no lead. So there is a ton of material out there. Even if your piping is new, the fixtures will be brass. And finally, any copper pipe that was installed, and the copper pipe was installed in the 40s, 50s, all the way up to 1986, and to join it, you used a lead saw. So every joint of those pipes, every couple, had a little lead saw. If it was done right, it's very little bit of lead is exposed to the pipe. Done sloppily, it could have run inside the pipe, so there could be a little bit more. But that's been prohibited. Corrosion control helps minimize the amount of lead that can come out of that. That's why we need to go on and test that and make sure the corrosion control is working.
Right.
So there's a lot out there.
But does Kim know if we actually have, like, in my son's school, it was built in the early 1900s, is it possible that there are actually lead pipes, like solid lead pipes, in some of our older schools? Because we do have, most of our schools, if you're doing the facilities master plan, you know, most of our schools are built like 1950s and before. So those schools that are really old, is it possible that there are actually lead pipes in the school, even though they're not online with water, but is there lead in those buildings?
I'll have to add that to my list of questions that I need to check on. What I can tell you, though, is that we've been doing the testing of the water, and so there'd be a little bit of a disconnect for me mentally between pipes that are lead and good tests that we've been getting. But let me make sure that I add that to our list of things that we publish and get that information out.
This will be our last question for the night. Please, if you have any other questions, please get them on note cards, and LaToya and Charlene will be glad to collect them.
Okay. I guess I remain unconvinced that exposure to lead in drinking water is not a public health issue. I mean, if we've got the standard of 15 parts per billion, obviously we've got a standard in place for a reason. I think that's what Gloria was saying earlier. And if the current management ethos is erring on the side of caution, then I would like to know where EPS stands in terms of blood testing in some of these schools. Can offer testing to the children for free? Can we track it long term? Can we find out if poisoning actually occurred building by building in places where they're coming back to elevated lead levels?
That question's been asked a couple times, and I'll also defer to the health professionals in terms of the health side of it. But we are working with the Boston Health Commission, and we are committed to working with families to make sure they do not have to pay for lead testing. So Mass Health covers 100% of that cost. If families have issue, we've given up the phone number. I don't have the phone number with me, but someone will make sure it's posted to call, and we will work with families to make sure that that's taken care of. In terms of testing in schools, our schools aren't set up to draw blood, and so what we think the best option is, and we've got, you know, I'll let these folks speak to it as well. The best thing, if you've got a concern, is to see your primary care physician and talk through the issues. Setting up KIMP in a school has a whole slew of potential additional health-related complications that the best place to do any testing, should you think that it's needed, would be with your primary care physician or at a clinic. But let me let the health professionals actually speak to that.
A couple of things. I wanted to say that one of the reasons I'm proud of that I've been working in Massachusetts for all this time is that the kind of community action that is happening and visible in this room happens here in Massachusetts. And there is a collegial attempt to make the environment as safe as it could possibly be, because believe me, this does not happen in most places, most cities, or most states. So we're proud, and I'm proud to see how this dialogue is going, because as your children's pediatrician, what I want to do as an advocate is to try and minimize any kind of risk and prevent any kind of poisoning or whatever it is. That said, in general, we are not recommending that the kids in the public school system be tested unless you had a particular reason to do that. We know that we screen them during the period of age that they are most likely to be poisoned, but once they get above age 5 or 6, they are much less likely to be poisoned, in part because they literally don't absorb the lead that is put into their gut, nor do you and I. So that if an older child or an adult is exposed to a certain amount of lead in water or anywhere else, dust, we don't get it into our body so much. So the amount of lead that we are hearing could possibly be in any of the highest water bubblers or water fountains that are in the Boston Public Schools is probably not enough to raise your pediatrician or us to a level of saying, okay, let's test your child. However, if you're anxious, as several of you clearly seem to be, sure, let's do it. What we can't do at that point is, let's say your child's lead level was 6, say. We can't point to a school as the source of that, as opposed to your neighbor who was doing a renovation or some lead that's in the paint in your windows, which is much more likely to be the source of the increase. So part of my job here is to reassure you that the amount of lead that I'm hearing about in the water systems in the school is not enough to cause me as a parent or me as a pediatrician enough anxiety to do it. But by all means, if you are anxious, do that.
I think we're going to have to take that question down and make sure we answer it later. At this time, did you want to have closeout thought, or was that your closeout thought?
I actually to praise you guys for what you're doing, because we do need to continue this advocacy. We do need to get rid of not just lead in pipes, but in our paint, in our whatever else, and other contaminations in the environment. There are lots of other ones. And we need to be advocates to keep on talking and keep on working with these guys who clearly are responsive to your concerns.
Thank you for that. And at this point, Kim's going to discuss next steps, and then we will call out.
So next steps. We talked a little bit about that earlier. We are committed to continue to provide information online. So all of the data in its granular state will be available. And we're getting feedback. So if you have feedback about the site, about how easy or how difficult it was to find something, or if you've got some idea as to what additional information would be helpful, we'd love to hear it. This is an evolving resource, and we really want it to be the best. We are working with R.W. Sullivan, which is a nationally recognized firm, working with the six pilot schools. And so again, we'll be making information available as it evolves in terms of bringing those six schools that are in the pilot and the four schools that have delegated testing online. We will not be putting them online until we've communicated that publicly to families. So you will not be in a situation where all of a sudden you discover that the water is back online. We will be making sure that we communicate that first before that happens. We also are going to be bringing back to the school committee an updated water policy. We do not yet have a date for that presentation, but we, as soon as we have that decided, we will be making that available as well. So we are having this same format of a meeting tomorrow for families, and we are going to be scheduling with some individual schools information sessions going forward as varied communities have been asking for them. So we'll make all that information available. We've been using the robocall system to communicate that home. And again, as you have questions or feedback, I'm sure your question is something that others have as well. So please don't hesitate to ask. We really do want to make sure that we're making all this information accessible.
So with that, I want to thank you all for taking the time to come out today. I want to especially thank those of you who were brave enough to ask your questions and submit questions. I do have two that will be the first to go on this document that will be provided. Thank you, Mr. Sullivan. Thank you, Ms. Wren. Thank you, Dr. Palfrey, for coming out and sharing your expertise with the audience.